considered as dedicated or considered as committed to the causes of Adivasis, and there was a very clear mention that only those kind of Christian missionaries who are opposed to the whole rights of Adivasis and who are only interested in conversions, they will be opposed off by the Vesak movement. Similarly, we would also find that there are some sympathetic voices of Adivasis in the whole administration system, and they were also had some sympathy from the Vesak movement. It was so, I would say, to understand Vesak movement and Birsa Munda's Urgula. In a clearer term was to understand what kind of Adivasi rights, were perceived by Birsa Munda and his followers. First thing is very sure that rights to autonomy. It was autonomy which was autonomy of land, autonomy of territory, autonomy of self, which was at the core of the Vesak movement. The second thing was the autonomy to territory, the space. So this is this whole idea of autonomy to a territory was what later on came out as the driving force behind the Jharkhand movement. And the third was the relationships of Adivasis with their ecology and with their with the other communities which were in the vicinity. How do we understand the relationship of Adivasis from the nature or ecology? And there are very, very interesting insights from the Birsa movement. I would just cite one example. When there was this Zamindari system and Sahukari system introduced by the Raj in Chotanagpur region, Birsa Munda called especially from the Adivasi communities for stopping cultivating rice, paddy. That was a very, very important call given by Birsa Munda, stop cultivating rice. This was done because cultivating paddy was one of the main source of calculating the rent and calculating the taxes. So he used this element, understanding of how a settled agriculture was detrimental to Adivasi autonomy. So once Adivasis stopped cultivating rice and started harvesting from the wild crops, the administrators, the Raj, got into a lot of problems because the land holdings, which was by them calculated by who is cultivating what, that understanding really went outside the window. And because the Adivasis started shifting from settled agriculture to harvesting wild crops, there was the autonomy of territory through the control over forests, through the control over natural resources, became more strengthened. So this is that deep philosophy, deep preaching of what is not just followed by the Vesak movement, but in the lives and what he called for and what it means for the Adivasi rights in today's context. Now something which is going very interesting, and I would come to that, and that comes from a very deep understanding of the Adivasi philosophy, which is connected with Adivasi rights. There are many economists who are giving alternate models of living, alternate models of understanding microeconomics. I myself, through one of the project and trying to understand, there was this one research to understand how people who are not wealthy can be much more, can have much more peaceful life, can have much more prosperous life. And this understanding is now gaining more acceptance in global institutions like World Bank and IMF. Coming back to these economic models, we have an understanding of class, which is mostly the economic class. So there are one very small class which is called the bourgeois class at the top of the hierarchy, and then there is the middle class, and there is the whole class of proletariat. But a different understanding of class, which is being now circulated as sustainable civilizations. Sustainable civilizations is basically communities who on their own resources can live on a very sustainable way, and Adivasis are now being considered as one of the sustainable societies or sustainable civilizations, or some are even naming Adivasis as the ecological civilizations. What it is actually? So this new understanding of class, there is one small class which overconsumes beyond its needs. So there is a class which has so much money which it doesn't need, from resources which it doesn't have, and from people who are not from their community. So there is this overconsuming class, and in present economic context we know who are this economic class. Just by saying that 5% of the total Indian population own around 71% of the total economic resources, these are the over-consuming classes. Then there is the other class, which is the sustainable class, which produces as much they want to consume. And there is, at the end of the ladder, there is the struggling classes. So this new understanding of classes, which I tell you how it is related to the whole Birsa Munda movement and his own teachings. So what happens is that there is a class which overconsumes because it takes away from the struggling classes, the classes which don't have enough land, the classes which don't have enough food on their plate, the classes which don't have enough money to survive on day-to-day basis, classes which don't have resources for their emergency times. So what over-consuming class is doing is that it is taking away from the struggling classes, and in between there are sustained communities which produce as much they need, and these sustained classes is where the Adivasis are standing today. Now relate this sustained class with the example which I gave from the preaching of Birsa Munda when he said that stop cultivating rice is a simple message, but if you go deep into it, it means that stop cultivating to pay taxes, stop cultivating for the state, stop cultivating for the dikus, stop cultivating for the markets. This is the very clear message which was given by Birsa Munda and which is still relevant in today's context. Now, what is happening is that not just the country, but across the globe, if we see which are the sustained classes, it is mostly the indigenous people's areas where they have able to preserve the resources, their forests, their water resources, their natural resources. This is the places where the environment is being saved. The overconsumption of resources is been restricted. When Adivasis are protesting against a coal mine or a bauxite mine or against a large scale dam, it is not just that they are protecting Adivasi rights. They are protecting the future of not just this country, but they are protecting the future of this globe. So it is not just the responsibility of the Adivasis to protect the river resources or protect the mineral resources or protect the environment, but it is everybody's responsibility. So here, when we are celebrating the Birsa Munda Jayanti, it should not just be the celebration of the Adivasis. It should not be just a celebration of people who have learned about the history of Adivasis, but it should be a celebration by every global citizen. Unfortunately, which is not happening today. Now, let's come to another concept which I would like, which is being discussed a lot by now. Based on these three classes, the new understanding of classes, वो जो सबसे ज़्यादा खा रहे हैं, जो इतना खा रहे हैं जितना वो पचा नहीं पा रहे हैं, वो जो उतना ही कमाते हैं जिनका जितना उनको ज़रूरत है, और वो जिनको वो भी नहीं मिल रहा है जितना उनके शरीर को उनके जिंदा रहने को ज़रूरत है, ये तीन प्रकार के जो वर्ग हैं, इन वर्गों की समझदारी जो है, ये एक नए सीख में, नए अवधारणा में निकल कर के आ रही है, और उस अवधारणा को आज जो है वहीं के लोग जो बिरसा मुंडा के बताए हुए रास्ते पर चल रहे हैं, जो बिरसा आंदोलन के बताए हुए रास्ते पर चल रहे हैं, और उस अवधारणा का नाम है आदिवासियत, और इन इंग्लिश वी कैन कॉल इट आदिवासीइज्म। आदिवासीइज्म और आदिवासियत, व्हाट इज इट? इट्स अ काइंड ऑफ अ न्यू फिलोसफी बेस्ड ऑन एज ओल्ड टीचिंग्स फ्रॉम द आदिवासी लीडर्स। What does it say? Adivasiyat is something, Adivasism is something which has been given by the first proponent of Adivasiyat was Birsa Munda. And that is why the understanding of Adivasiyat, Adivasism becomes the most relevant concept in today's situation. What is this Adivasiyat? Adivasiyat is based on what I said in the beginning. Adivasis depend on relationships. Relationship between Adivasi community and nature, ecology. Adivasi communities depend on relationship between tribals and non-tribals. Adivasi community, Adivasiyat depends on relationship between human beings and animals. Adivasiyat depends on relationships which is between men and women. And this kind of philosophy was first given by our great leader Dharti Aba Birsa Munda. Now, what are these relationships I am talking about? Let's start with the relationship between men and women. We all know that there has been so many PhD theses, books, articles written up about Adivasi women, their situation in the Adivasi community. We have been going through an unprecedented kind of break of trust between human beings. One such break of trust we see right now in the most popular movement, that hashtag MeToo movement. Why is hashtag MeToo movement coming? What hashtag MeToo movement can relate with the Birsaite movement? The hashtag MeToo movement is also about what kind of place for women, not just in Adivasi society, but also in a general society. We see we now know that as we are moving, we are becoming more barbaric towards all our own fellow human beings. We see so much of violence in this society, violence in the form of sexual harassment, violence in the form of massive caste violence. What does Birsa movement talk about this, or what does Birsa movement's teaching talk about it? It teaches about how relationships on a common understanding of respect, self-respect as well as respect for other human beings. When I when we know that there was a very when even in the most difficult of times there was a very clear instruction given by Bhagwan Birsa Munda about how not to be opposite to people, the even the non-tribals, non-tribal bhikkhus who were supportive to the rights of Adivasis, to the autonomy of Adivasis at that time. In a very clear language, when we see, for example, the teachings of Birsa Munda on, say, alcohol assumption, clearly says, after consuming alcohol, we all become animals, we become savages, and we don't want to be savages in front of people who loot us. We know how alcohol plays a very big role in the whole issue of domestic violence, especially in the rural communities today. There is so much of learning from the whole issue of Birsite movement, which comes to the concept, very concept of Adivasiya. Similarly, the relationship of human beings with nature. Why he said that stop cultivating paddy. Stop cultivating for the state, stop cultivating for the sahukar, stop cultivating for the taxes. Because when there is profits to be envisioned from natural resources, there will be always overconsumption. And there can't be a sustainable relationship between man and nature, man and other human beings, or even with human beings and animals. There can't be a relationship which is based on overconsumption. That is why this whole concept of Adivasiyat, which is now gaining grounds in various Adivasis areas, it has encompassed the teachings of Bhagwan Birsa Munda. And that is the place where I come to the movement of Pathalgadi. As we know, there has been so much bad press been given, of course, because there is very few Adivasi writers, journalists or intellectuals who get space in the media, mainstream media. So what most of us we read that Pathalgadi movement, a movement which was based on the idea of autonomy given by Bhagwan Birsa Munda, it is considered as unconstitutional. And in many places, this the leaders of Adivasi leaders of Pathalgadi movement have been arrested and put into jails. They are being considered as breakers of law and order, whereas these people, they are asserting their own autonomy. So, on one hand, based on the principles of Adivasiism, which is the basis of Pathalgadi movement, of having autonomy on their own resources, on their village resources, on their natural resources. So what the Pathalgadi movement is doing basically is that it is saying that our resources should be used by us, it should not be consumed or over-consumed by the mining companies, the state, or it should not be, it should not become just as an economic resource. And people who are practicing Adivasiyat in a sense which is not just detrimental for the Adivasi communities, but also for the global community, for each and every global citizen who wants this nature to be protected for the coming generations. And in return of that, these Adivasi communities, leaders who are trying to protect their autonomy, trying to protect their relationship with nature, trying to protect Adivasi. They are considered as anti-national and they are being put into jails. So you can see that this struggle, we know about the class struggles. The new understanding of class, the over-consuming class, the sustained class, sustainable class, and the struggling class. There is a clear struggle of classes between this class. The over-consuming class, the Ambanis and the Adanis, they are looking how their profits can be maximized, how new mines can be given, how land bank can be used for making more and more profits. And there is, on the other hand, the sustained class, which is trying to save every drop from the river, every precious coal, every precious gold, every precious bauxite, iron ore, to be saved for the next generation. They are coming into the way of this over-consuming class. And that's why we see so much of violence in Adivasi areas. And at the end, if we need to really think of the future of the struggling classes, and most of the struggling classes, I would say, come from the marginalized, most marginalized backgrounds like Dalits, the landless agricultural laborers, the people who are being trafficked from there. If we need to address these issues, the onus, the buck stops at the doorsteps of the over-consuming classes, not at the doors of Adivasis. They need to control their hunger, their thirst for profits. And that is how this Adivasiya could be one of the key instruments which can preserve not just the climate but the future of our coming generations. Saying this, I would stop myself here. Thank you very much to you all. Full Johan.
बहुत धन्यवाद मिस्टर अभय जी. आपने इस वक्तव्य के लिए एक बहुत अच्छी खासी ऐतिहासिक पृष्ठभूमि तैयार की है, जिसके आगे हम